everyone, my name is Iris France, 我叫林婉如. Today we're going to talk about how to find the consumption bundle, the best consumption bundle, given our budget constraint and our Cobb-Douglas utility function. So you can see this is our Cobb-Douglas utility function. Utility of good 1 and good 2 is equal to x1 to the a and x2 to the 1 minus a's power. And you can see that is our indifference curve corresponding to our utility function. So our goal is this. We are going to equate the marginal rate of substitution to the slope of our budget line. Therefore, we'll be able to find this optimal consumption bundle, x1 and x2 star. So how do we do that? In our last video, we already talked about how to find the marginal rate of substitution of a Cobb-Douglas utility function. Now, I hope you have already watched that. So we're going to continue from there. Now, our marginal rate of substitution from our previous video, we found out that according to this Cobb-Douglas utility function, our marginal rate of substitution is equal to negative a divided by 1 minus a times x2 over x1. And we also know that the slope of our budget line is equal to negative p1 over p2. Now we're going to equate the two and also use our budget constraint. Our budget constraint is the second equation to find out our optimal consumption bundle. So we have two equations. Equation one, so here I didn't do anything to it. I'm just taking away the negative signs so it's easier. Our equation one, which is equating our marginal rate of substitution to the slope of our budget line. That's equation one. Equation two is our budget constraint. With these two equations, we have two equations and two unknowns. The unknowns are x1 and x2, and that's the optimal consumption bundle we're trying to find. So with two equations, two unknowns, we'll be able to solve for x1 and x2. So here, we have our equation 1, and we're going to start to work on that first. I'm going to multiply those sides by x1 times 1 minus a over a on both sides. So on the left-hand side, you can see I didn't do anything to it. I just multiplied both sides by x1 times 1 minus a divided by a. And after that, I can cross out several terms. So x1 and x1 here, they cross out. And a, they cross out. 1 minus a and 1 minus a here, they both cross out. So on the left-hand side, I'm left with x2. On the right-hand side, that's equal to, I'm just going to rearrange a term, putting 1 minus a divided by a first, then 1 times p1 over p2 times x1. So I have a relationship between x1 and x2. So I'm going to plug this term into the second equation, which is our budget constraint. So where's our budget constraint? I'm just going to move it down. I didn't change it at all. So it's your p1 x1 plus p2 x2 times n. And I'm not going to do anything to p1 x1. But for x2, I'm going to plug this term in. So x2 is equal to 1 minus a divided by a times p1 over p2 times x1. So I'm just going to plug this in here. So you're left with this. And I'm going to move here. Notice that I can cross out P2 and P2 here. So I'm going to cross it out. And what am I left with is P1 x1 plus 1 minus a divided by a. I didn't change that. And times P1 x1. And that's equal to m. The only thing I did here was crossing out P2 and P2. So what is our next step? Notice we have P1 x1 on both first and second term. So I'm going to pull it out. And I'm left inside the bracket I have 1, because 1 times P1 x1 is just equal to P1 x1. And the second term, when I pull out P1 x1, I'm left with 1 minus a divided by a. And the whole term is equal to m. And the rest really is just algebra. I am going to write 1 as a divided by a. Why is that? Because I want to combine these two terms. So I'm just going to change 1 to A divided by A. And I didn't change anything, but I combine them together. So in the numerator, I have A plus 1 minus A, and that 2 term crosses out. And you're left with P1X1 times 1 over A is equal to M. So I'm able to find X1. So the optimal X1 will be equal to A divided by P1 times M. I'm just multiplying both sides by A and divide both sides by P1, and I can find X1. And after that, I can go back and plug this back to our budget constraint, which is here. Then I will be able to find X2. So again, I'm using the budget constraint. P1X1 plus P2X2 is equal to M. And now I am going to plug this term into X1. So you can see that there is no more X1. So I'm left with only one unknown. So I can solve for X2. And I'm going to leave this part for you as an exercise. But at the end, you will find X2 is equal to 1 minus A divided by P2 times M. And that's my optimal consumption bundle. So now some of you will complain, why is this P1 and P2, why is it M? Why don't you give me a number? Here's the reason. Because your M can change, your budget can change. You might have a salary increase and the price level. No need to say it's changing all the time. And therefore, if you use numbers, once the price changes or the budget changes, then everything has to change. But if you use M, if you use P1, then whenever your prices change or your budget has changed, you just need to plug in the new number and then you get the optimal consumption bundle. And that's the reason why economists like to use parameters instead of numbers. So I hope this helps, and I'll see you next time.